Hello all. Okay, so I am doing this multi-part tutorial because I have been getting a lot of comments and messages of people wanting the steps of how to move abroad. So I am going to speak specifically about Uganda, but this pretty much would work for the most part in most countries that you may want to move to, give or take. And I am only speaking, again, no one comes for me. I'm only talking about a foreigner moving to a different country, okay? All right, so the first thing I would definitely recommend is researching a few countries to meet your criterias. And some of your criteria that you should think about is that the business community, and at least maybe for the majority of the population, but really the business community and then the city community speaks English, right? So for the most part, a country that is taught in school in English would be a good English or Spanish or any language you speak. Those are my two languages. So Uganda fell right into that because they're taught English in school. Mostly everyone in business and in the city speaks English, so it works for me perfectly, right? So that's one. You also want to learn the exchange rate. The exchange rate, the value of your dollar, is going to let you know somewhat what the cost of living will be, or you'll be able to gauge later on, you know, what that is. And there's apps like xe.com, which is the one that I use, and I download their app to always change the currency value for something. Oh, it's 30,000 shillings. Let me use my app. And you use that a lot. You're going to use that app religiously during your research and everything. Another thing is that I would Google Earth, the areas, like the city where you may want to move, or just a capital city, and just look at the business areas and just Google Earth walk some areas where you're allowed, you know, with that little man. That would be another one, right? And then most crucially is that in your state, most likely, there will be a community of that country. For me, I found the community of Uganda. Obviously, I met someone from Uganda and my network opened, but to be honest, on my own, once I realized it was going to be Uganda for me, I would go to the restaurants, meet other Ugandans, you know, just exchange numbers. They then would invite me to events. I would, you know, then sign up for like trips that they may go on. I joined unions. I traveled for annual events. I was just in the community, and I got most of my information from those people, as far as like, oh, this costs this much, this costs that. Even learning a bit of the language, I learned a few sayings while still in California. So I just collected a lot of information from those people, right? But I would also say caution who you speak to, because there are those people who don't really have anything positive to say and can really mess up a good chance or an opportunity for you to try something or experience something just because you listen to a local that, you know, told you some stuff and you didn't use any way to verify that. You have no way of verifying that. I mean, you can try, but I definitely had a lot of people in California, not a lot, there was just these few that just really had nothing positive to say. And to be honest, what I didn't appreciate about that was that once I landed there and I realized life, I realized that what she was spewing and he was spewing to me was really not detrimental to me moving. But I would have changed my mind if I was weak-minded, or if I just didn't, you know what I mean? Just went off with a few people told me, like, don't be that person. Just do your research very well. It doesn't hurt to plan a first trip to actually see if, you know, it's how people are telling you. So don't listen to everything. Really be biased in what you're taking in, right? So that would also be key. Okay. So now you've done a bit of research on a few destinations you selected, and you've connected with a bit of the community. I would say also hit up social media. I joined a lot of Facebook groups Facebook pages. I was on LinkedIn, on Twitter. I was just following not just expat groups, but things within my industry. So my background was entertainment and I wanted to do tourism and wildlife. So I looked for groups in Uganda that were doing those things, right? And I became very active and developed conversations with people through these, you know, public forums and groups. Okay, so this is part three of tips and things that I did when I moved abroad from the US to Uganda, but pretty much applies if you're moving to most countries, but do your research. Okay, so now I wanted to talk about communication and phones and phone service, internet. All right, so I would always for sure recommend bring a spare phone. Hands down, bring a spare phone. Smartphone of a less value, unlocked, that in case of anything, whether stolen, whether damaged, you have a spare phone, okay? So also you would arrive and go to one of the two major, however many major in whatever country you pick, phone companies are used, mobile phone companies. I would suggest picking the same company that the people you're going to be calling use, the same network, because it is cheaper to make and receive phone calls when you're part of the same network, right? So in Uganda is Airtel or MTN. I was an Airtel girl. So my friends would always have two numbers and I would always pick the Airtel, but for the most part, everyone has two. So that's a really cool tip. And to get a SIM card, you could do this on arrival. You can just walk into one of their headquarters office with your passport and valid visa and a few dollars. It's like 10,000 shillings. That's like a few dollars. And and they give you a SIM card. And then you can add an internet package and you can add text and calling. So that is how you set up your phone. I would say that before you leave the phone office, because it can happen, it's happened many times, your phone doesn't register the SIM card correctly, so make sure you don't leave the mobile office until you have everything working, because then you can end up being in a very long line trying to do some technical support. Okay. The apps to download before you leave are definitely WhatsApp and things like Telegram. You know, make sure that the important people in your life download those apps, or, you know, get a free Google voice number. That's another way I was able to communicate and still have an American number. And it's internet based. You know, if you're like with T-Mobile, AT&T, if you have it, I don't know how many countries Google Voice is in, but check it out. You can get a free line and use it as your internet line to communicate with your family now abroad to you. So that's communication. If I think of anything else, I'll add it on another video. So now the next most important thing I would say after you're, you know, connected, which is internet and phone, I would say is power, right? So I would definitely invest in having two power banks. I have particular ones that I literally had one that lasted me 5 years. And it was such a good power bank. My goodness. It even fell off of a motorcycle and still was running really good. So, what was the brand? I'm gonna list the brand up here. Maybe provide a link somewhere so you guys can take a look. It's definitely a good power bank. But you want a power bank that will power your cell phone. Always keep it charged. Because, okay, in some countries, like Uganda, like Dominican Republic, like many others, the electricity is not always on. I have to say it happened very few times, more closer towards the end of living in Uganda where the electricity would go. I really also think it depends on certain areas that you may choose to move. But I always was prepared. I had power banks to charge my cell phone. I also had little solar panel. And I would just always make sure that these things were charged so that, you know, when electricity is not there, I just am able to make it last a little longer. And when the electricity don't come and everything's off, then it's just time to relax. Maybe chill back, have a beer, chill, you know? So it's really not a big deal. Like the whole electricity thing, the whole maybe not paid road things, like if you could just get past these little things that don't function to perfection, you literally just live the best life ever. So really go in there, you know, go in there really thinking of like solutions to these problems that you may find, right? Because also if you're gonna stay for an extended time, the rent, once we get there, right? The rent, if you're gonna stay in a nice area, most likely the electricity won't go out as much. And the rent honestly is somewhere around like literally $200-$300 in a nice area. Like where I lived, I was paying $250 and electricity barely. I think in the entire time I stayed there, the electricity went out about three times for about 15 minutes. Okay, but maybe about four or five times for about 15 minutes, no longer. So like, man, come on, I can deal with that. Okay. Okay, another solution to the electricity thing, if you must stay connected, let's say you're working on something, I would then use a hotel as an alternative. There's a lot of very well put together hotels that will turn on a generator real quick, or you can't even tell that they're in the area that their electricity is gone, right? So I would go, you know what I mean? Buy a drink, have a meal, and just sit there and use the internet. Pick where you go, right? Because there is these type of places where you could just continue to use the internet, or they'll just give you like a little piece of paper and where the internet only lasts like 15, 20 minutes, 30 minutes. So learn which are the places that will cater to you when the electricity is gone, should you be working. And because the electricity may be unstable, I'll give you this piece of advice because I did this error, is if you're going to carry a external hard drive with you, do not make it one that you need to plug in to for it to work. It should be the kind like this one that just connects to your computer, right? Don't get the kind that connects to electricity. That can mess you up, obviously. If electricity, there's ever a chance electricity can go off, that can mess you up. Okay, so let's now talk about housing. Okay, so thanks to the people I met in Los Angeles from the Uganda community, I met my friend who introduced me to who became my friends in Uganda. And thanks to him all the way from LA, I ended up being roommates for the first four trips that I went there, long stays. I would stay from 4 to 6 months. I had a roommate, a few roommates, and that was a blessing, let me tell you. It's way better than living alone. Not only was I able to save on rent because we were cutting the electricity bill, the water bill, and the rent, you know, divided, you know, how it had to be based on how we were sharing, right? But even better was that living with them helped me so much with then the most important thing that we're gonna talk about, which is transportation. Oh, they were the holy grail of saving me when it came to not getting cheated in Uganda with this local transportation. I'm gonna explain way more of that on this next part. Let's say you don't want to move in with anyone and you want your own place. Those friends that you know will be able to do some research for you or be able to connect you with someone. The thing is that you first want to have your budget already known. I usually will let them know my budget is somewhere from $250 to $300, no more, right? And for what kind of space you want. So make sure you have your budget. And over there, you don't pay, in Uganda specifically, you don't pay month to month. You kind of give your deposit and you pay a few months in advance, which is great because then you don't have to worry about that, right? So if you're having to make that decision, I would say for the first week of you arriving, get an Airbnb. You never know. You may even work out some deal with that Airbnb property. But get an Airbnb for the first week until you find a place. It's pretty easy to find a place once you have someone locally kind of helping you. Make sure the right person is helping you. I have definitely not gotten ripped off by brokers who find apartments, but I could have if I was naive and let them get away with it. That's a whole nother video of how they try to get you. But just be very smart. Like, I'm a hustle. Like, you can't get things past me like this. Like, you know, I'm woke. I know the game, you know? So just be very aware. And also, when you're doing such transactions, make sure that you request the people that you're dealing with to speak in English in front of you. Very important. And if somehow you're feeling some kind of iffy, some type of way, one of the things that I did when people would have conversations that were crucial to what I was doing, but they chose to speak a different language that I didn't understand and something that involved me, is that I would record the conversation on my phone and then ask my friends later, like, hey, what were they saying here? Because, you know, it's going to be very hard to get people to around you. Even in business, it's going to be very hard for you to get people to always speak your language where they won't jump to their local dialect. So, you know, that's a bit of a rough patch if you're trying to do business, to not understand what's going on around you. So maybe just kind of demand that if something's very crucial to what you need, that they speak English. Now, we've covered so much. Now transportation would be the thing on the menu next. Okay, so now transportation. Well, we have Uber. I feel so included when I say we. We have Uber in Uganda. We have other app-related transportations. Like, let's say if you feel comfortable taking motorcycle taxis, which is the fastest way to move around the cities, the major cities, there's several apps that you just download, so the drivers are a bit more trusted. But again, I guess when you ride a motorcycle, you kind of take a risk. But I gotta say, I was taking Bora Boras. Those are the motorcycle taxis. They're called Bora Boras. I was taking them religiously, always, for all 7 years, up until a few months ago when I went to go visit Uganda last year. And on my day of arrival, I got knocked off the motorcycle by a big dump truck, but God loves me and I'm alive. I'll discuss my scars on another video. So, you know, I took them for 7 years and it was so easy. But I mean, I guess now, because I went through that experience, I will not really want to be on a motorcycle taxi. Maybe when there is like the jam, when the traffic jam is very busy and the cars are not moving that fast, I would take a motorcycle taxi. But generally, when that was no longer an option for me last year, I hired a driver with a car. And that was very affordable. You know what? I ain't even gonna say it here because, I mean, people here on TikTok just be having some feelings about the prices I talk about. But it's pretty affordable, I will tell you, to also hire, as a foreigner, hire a local driver with a vehicle on those days where you have to run errands, right? They also have taxis, which are little mini buses. I would also somewhat caution those. I would only take the ones that are at like specific stages. Like, the, you know, in general, this is where the buses that go to Entebbe line up. The ones that are kind of registered stops, per se, right? Do those. Private car, motorcycles, and the taxis, which are the buses, is the way to move around. You know, car rental, I don't really think that's liable. I never did the car rental. It could be an option. I don't know.